worked tirelessly to confront the disparity faced by minorities in Virginia. He supports greater access to health care and more state contract for SWAM businesses. He and the First Lady have made it their priority to reduce childhood anger. And of course, he has made history by restoring the voting rights of 2,006 Virginians, 200,006 Virginians. He doesn't back down when faced with negative political rhetoric. He just keeps working hard for all of Virginians. It is my pleasure to introduce the Honorable Terry McCullough, the 72nd Governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia.
They have been besieged with calls since I made my announcement. We have now been getting people from other departments to come work at the Secretary of the Commonwealth's office just to answer the phone calls and to help people. And so if we can have our Restoration Rights staff stand up and give them a great round of applause. They have been very busy. And we're an honor, and I thank the reverends who prayed for us and prayed over us. But you're right, it was my greatest day as governor. I've had so many exciting days as the 72nd governor of the Commonwealth. As Dolores mentioned, the work that my wife and I are doing to make sure every child that goes to school has access to a healthy breakfast. Thousands of children now are now getting access to a healthy meal. How do you expect a child to learn if they go to school, they don't have a breakfast and they're hungry? So we're fixing that through summer meals and all the things we've done on the economy to lift everybody up. But clearly, when I stood on those steps of that Capitol, and for those of you there, it was an exhilarating moment for me and for the crowd. Most of you thought I was making another general restoration of rights speech. And I talked about how I had already restored the rights of 18,000 Virginians, which I'm proud of saying is more than the past seven governors combined. We hadn't done enough, and you could feel the murmur in the crowd that something else was coming. And I went through, and I stood in front of that Capitol where in 1902 they had used race to deny people the right to vote. They had put a poll tax in. They put a literacy test in. They had disenfranchised felons. You know what that state senator had said? To stop the darkies from being able to vote so that the whites could control the electoral ballot box. We know what they said. We know why they did it. So for me to stand there as the 72nd governor and erase 114 years of racial injustice to do the right thing, I will tell you, folks, was the greatest thing. Rights. I'm proud to say that when I ran for governor, I traveled and attended more African-American churches than any candidate ever running for governor. And for those of you that were in those churches, I told you that I was going to do everything I can to help those disenfranchised folks get their rights back. JJ, you went to hundreds of those churches with me. I gave the same speech everywhere I went. And then I got into office. And I did what I thought I could do and started out looking at the process, and LeVar and I tore the laws apart and looked at it, analyzed what we could do. We took a 13-page form. I mean, come on. We knew why it was 13 pages. We knew why you had to have a notary. It was all to make it difficult. We took drug offenders who were classified as violent. We said, that's not right. So we got rid of that category, made them nonviolent so they could immediately get their rights back to vote. We took violent offenders and got it from 5 down to 3 years. We got rid of what I thought, honestly, was a remnant of the poll tax. You could get your voting rights back if you had outstanding court fees, which, of course, the interest charges. Some folks came up to us and said, I owe $17,000, I owe $45,000. I will never vote again. So we got rid of all of that. And through the process, we had event after event. And I stood on stage and one gentleman came up to me with tears in his eyes and said, I haven't been able to vote in 60 years. He said, I made a mistake when I was 19 years old. And I can tell you, folks, it makes an impact on your soul when someone who is 79 years old stands next to you and breaks down into tears and tells you this was the happiest day of his life. And day after day, and what really ate at my soul was those fathers who came up to me and said on election days, they would go to voting polling booths, hoping that somebody had dropped their I voted sticker, so that they could pick that sticker up and put it on their lapel and go home and tell their children that they voted that day because they were too embarrassed to tell their children they didn't have the right to vote. It was at that point I said, enough is enough. And then we saw the governor of Kentucky before he left office last year. He restored the rights of all the felons in the Commonwealth of Kentucky. Now, we've been talking about it, thinking about it, and people said, well, I don't know, legally. And it was at that point when I read that article, I called the secretary and said, no more excuses. I want you to get the best legal minds you can get in here. If there's a way to do this, I will do it. And thanks to our Attorney General, and thanks to A.E. Dick Howard, who is the constitutional expert, who wrote our 71 Constitution. And I can tell you, we kept it very close, 4 or 5 people, because I wanted to make sure I had all my ducks in a row and everything was right. But when I finally, when the wire finally came down and AE had called and said, the governor has the full authority to do this. He has full clemency powers. No one else has them but him. Yeah. He can restore the rights of every single thing. I said, well, it's time to get over here, folks. So, people are going to ascribe all kinds of theories, political theories. Let me be clear, folks. Those who know me well, this has nothing to do with politics. This has to do with justice.
Yes,
this has to do with morality.
Yes.
These
yes.
people have served their time.
Yes,
they're done with probation. They're done with parole.
That's right.
They're free in society.
That's right.
They're going to churches. They're going to our grocery stores. They're working. They have family members. They have houses, and they're paying taxes.
That's right.
Why should they let them access to our family? And let's be honest, what I did was get us in line with like 39 other states in the United States of America. Why is it that Virginia always has to be at the bottom when it comes to helping people and lifting people up? Why am I fighting my life to get 400,000 Virginians quality health care through Medicaid expansion, which we've already paid for? Why do we have to continue to do this? Let us reach our hands out and help people. That is why I ran for governor. And that is why I took the action. And let me tell you this, I will take action every single month till I leave this office to continue to make sure every county gets the voting rights back. So, I thank you. And yesterday, you know, we put out the graphs and the charts, and Secretary of the Commonwealth wanted to get all that out. I'll be honest with you, that didn't mean a whit to me. I don't care how long you've been out. It's the right thing to do once you've paid your debt to society. A judge and a jury have determined your sentence.
That's right.
You have paid the price. You are done with the legal system. You are back in society. And we had a discussion. Governor, what do we do about violent felons? There is no difference to me in the sense that once you have paid your debt to society, I want you back feeling good about yourself. I want you to have a job. I want you to pay taxes. I want you back in the system. So, I thank you for coming here tonight, but nobody should have any question about where I stand on these issues. I have talked about it. It is in the marrow of my bones. This is personal to me because I have met so many people whose lives have been affected. And the calls and the letters that I have received since I took that action. You could sit in your office and close that door, break into tears, and read these letters that have come in from folks. Folks, this is why we're in public service. This is why you run for office, to help people. Not to disenfranchise folks, not to deny folks access to health care, not to make sure that every child has the best education. I just put $1 billion into education, the single largest investment in the history of the Commonwealth of Virginia, because every child ought to have quality education. So I need your help. I think big, I act big. Some of the folks on the other side think small and act small. I'm trying to build a new community here. I'm trying to make Virginia the greatest state in the entire United States of America. That is my goal. You cannot do it by putting walls up around your state, by denying folks access to the best education, the best health care, the best transportation system. That's how I think. I don't get out of bed wanting to be 40 or 50. We're one of the four worst states in the nation on disenfranchisement. That is embarrassing as a governor.
Yes, sir.
Well, we're done. Now we're at the top. And I hope other governors take a lesson from what I did. If we can do this without history here in the Commonwealth of Virginia, we can do this anywhere.
That's right.
But that is the first step. I have done my part. Now it's up to you to register to vote, and then on Election Day,
yeah.
And this idea, all the blood automatically votes for candidates. I told the leadership of the Republican Party, stop complaining. Go out and earn these people's rights and their votes. And why you think you can't get their votes? Well, that's not a great election message. Spend your time lifting people up. That's why you need to be in politics. And let me tell you, folks, this is just the start. We are going to take this next level. Let's go out and register those voters.
Yeah.
And let's show up and send a message that we are the greatest state in the United States of America.